this video is going to seem very much like an anti-running campaign, but it's not. It's the exact opposite. I love running. It's my favorite form of exercise. But the problem is, when you're afforded the luxury of a heel strike in a cushioned, supportive shoe, things can go very wrong very quickly. Heel strike and reach. So we've spoken about heel strike and how bad it is before.
If you had one card to play, if you could only change one technical variable to make the greatest improvement in your cohort of athletes, it wouldn't take people from doing a heel strike and or a flat strike or a toe strike. You want to make everyone suddenly do a nice dorsiflexed midfoot strike under the center of mass to get that spring forward.
But here's a full breakdown of why. When we walk, we strike with the heel, roll through the outside of the foot, and then come back off the big toe as we roll through the gait cycle. That's fine, and that's the best way to control your speed, keep your balance at a low sort of intensity. But whenever you run, whether it's for a 100 meter sprint, a marathon, or you're chasing after a ball, the goal is to be as efficient as possible. That means any braking forces should be eliminated. Striking the ground on your heel out in front of the body is basically doing the exact opposite. It's a braking force sending you backwards. So evolution did us wrong in a whole bunch of ways. I mean, the shoulder as a ball and socket joint, come on. And the VMO versus all that lateral quad mass when it comes to keeping the patella in its groove, it's just ridiculous. One thing it got right is the Achilles calf complex. When we run on our midfoot, the calf and the Achilles work as a spring, absorbing and giving us back energy. Your Achilles is so strong that it gives you back 30% of the energy you put into the ground back free. That's why it's easier to bounce quickly up and down off the ground as opposed to going slow and using your muscles. When you bounce quick, you use those tendons like springs, helping you give you back that elastic energy. When we heel strike, instead of using that amazing rubber band system we have on the back of the leg, we put all the force into this tiny little muscle on the front of your leg, the tibialis anterior. This tiny little muscle here to control the foot, stop it slamming into the ground after we heel strike, and to absorb all those ground reaction forces. I mean, just look at the size difference. You've got this tiny tibialis anterior at the front and this massive calf complex at the back. Tib Ant had one small job, to lift the foot up to clear the ground when we sprint and walk. It was not designed to absorb huge forces when we slam our heels into the ground. If we'd evolved to run at speeds with a heel strike, we would have a tibialis anterior the size of a gastrocnemius, and we'd have feet shaped like those old Skechers shoes.
It feels like you're walking on sand, like your heel's actually sinking as the foot rolls naturally forward and easily pushes off with the toe pad, propelling you into your next step.
When you strike the ground with the heel out in front of the body, you kind of force yourself to have to drag your center of mass back on top of the foot into that next gait cycle. Not only does this increase the amount of time you spend on the ground, it also loads up your hamstrings as opposed to your glutes. When you strike the ground out in front of your body, you have to drag and pull yourself through using the hamstring. When you walk and you heel strike, it's not that big of a deal. You're only dealing with sort of 1 to 2 times your own body weight in ground reaction forces. As you speed up and get to a running and then a sprinting type speed, you can be dealing with up to 6 to 8 times your own body weight in ground reaction forces on a single leg with every stride. That's an enormous amount of force, and there's a lot of room for stuff to go wrong. When you land with a straight leg out in front of the body, that force is sent rocketing up the entire kinetic chain, through the heel, into the shins, the front of the knee, and even into the lower back. When you strike the ground on your midfoot under your body, well, first of all, there's just less force because now you're not braking. But second, your glutes and your calves can do the work they're supposed to, working as springs and elastic bands to absorb and generate energy as you run. Now here's where shoes come in. It's not physically possible to heel strike in something like this or in bare feet. Those 200,000 nerve endings on the bottom of your feet will quickly tell you change your tactic and do something different. When you add the cushioning of a sneaker like this, it blinkers those 200,000 nerve endings, dampening the effect of the force, meaning you can strike and effectively you won't feel it. But here's the catch. Just because you've got cushioning on the shoe doesn't mean those forces disappear. They simply slow down. So that cushioning on your shoe, because you can't feel it immediately and the sensory system isn't as active, the forces are still there. You just don't feel it acutely and instantly. Instead, the forces have passed up the kinetic chain, and because they're a little bit slower and kind of dampened out by the shoe, you don't get that immediate feedback that you would if you ran barefoot and with the heel strike.